Welcome back to part 10 of A Beautiful Game. This is the Karma rendering series, and in this part we're going over some advanced Karma settings. So in the previous parts we've gone over some of the more commonly used elements of Karma and Solaris. So at this point you should be rendering with no problem in most cases. However, there are some situations that call for some very niche settings. And so those settings we're going to cover in this part. Instead of having to scrounge around for information on Karma, I'm going to try and include as much information here as possible, just so that you know where those settings are when you're working on your own project. We're going to be looking at things like deep camera maps, how to exclude particular passes from your deep EXR renders, how you can crop a render, some EXR compression options, and a couple of other things. So let's get into it. If we open up p10_advanced.hip, you'll see this. We just have a shaped volume based on a camera, and it has some noise applied. Right, so if we go into this advanced settings tab, you'll notice that we just have the setup over here with the camera, merge node, and we can drop a Karma node. So before I get into deep and all of that, I just want to show you a couple of things about cropping. So sometimes you may render out an image and then notice that you have a particular area where there's artifacts, or it's noisy, or the material doesn't look as good as you'd like, and you'd like to re-render just a particular area. Now that can be troublesome because you may think that you'd have to re-render the entire image, but what you can do is you can crop a section of a view and then render just that section. And to do that, we can go over here to our Karma render tab. If we go over to the image output aspect ratio, so that's the aspect ratio conform policy, we have this data window NDC. Now this data window NDC, if I'm not mistaken, it doesn't work perfectly in Karma yet. I may be mistaken about that. Like, all of these settings don't really have much in terms of documentation yet, so a lot of the stuff is just my own trial and error. So if you do understand this better, then please let me know. But as far as I know, you can't overscan with Karma just yet. That may not be true, so again, please correct me if I'm wrong. So with data window NDC, you have the minimum X value as a percentage of where the window should start. So if we're talking about this render window over here, so this highlighted area, and if we click on our camera, it's this area here, right, with this red outline. Now, usually you could drag these handles and this would control your render area, but in Karma that doesn't work. If we switch to our Karma render node and then back to our camera, you'll see that it has reset. But those handles will help me explain what this is. So over here, we have the minimum X value, the minimum Y value, the maximum X value, and the maximum Y value. So that explains where, in terms of a percentage, each of these borders should be. So if we wanted to push the left border up by 10%, we would change it to 0.1. And if we wanted to bring the right border in by 10%, we would reduce it by 0.1. So we would change this value over here to 0.9. And so what that would do is it would crop out that area over there and that area over there, and we wouldn't have to render all of that extra stuff. So let's just say that we want to remove 25% off of the left side, you would do something like 0.25, right? Remember, this is the minimum X. This one over here is the maximum X. So if we want to remove 25% off of the maximum X, so 25% off the right, we could do 0.75. If we wanted to push the border up by 25% from the bottom, we can do 0.25, or the second parameter. And if we wanted to reduce the top one by 25%, we can do 0.75 again. Right, so if we just render to mplay, you should see that we have a cropped window. So as you can see, all of this gray over here represents the areas that are no longer being rendered. So we are now removing 25% of the top, bottom, left, and right. And this is what we're rendering. Now, as you can see, it keeps the resolution, right? This is the full 1280 by 720, and it's rendering only a section of it. It's not filling the entire resolution with this window. To do that, what you can do is go over to the actual camera. So I'm just going to reset this over here. You can control middle mouse to reset. If we go over to the camera, under Karma, we have the screen window. By default, it's off. We can say set or create, as we've done before with the LPE tags. And over here, your screen window represents the same thing. This one works a bit differently in that 0 represents the center. So -1 is -1 to the left, 1 is that way to the right, and then -1 is at the bottom, and 1 is at the top. So in this case, we can actually just do the Karma viewport render and change the settings from here. Now do keep in mind that if you make a change to a particular window, it'll keep the resolution and so it'll do some stretching. So if we do something like -0.5, you'll notice that it keeps the resolution and it stretches. To correct that, you would need to reduce one of these other values over here to 0.5, so something like this. And what that'll do is it'll just crop in like that. However, the difference is this renders the full resolution. So as opposed to actually cropping out all of the extra stuff, this is actually just changing what the view is focused in on. So it'll still render at that 1280 by 720. Now, this is where I was saying I'm not entirely sure if this works properly, but the data window NDC is meant to be able to render overscan. You would change this to a negative value and you change this to a value greater than one. And what it should give is overscan on these edges. Overscan is useful if you have something like camera shake in your compositing process, because you need that extra information, right? The camera would shake and move a little bit past the bounds of each border over here. So say your camera shakes to the right, you would want a little bit of overscan on the side. So an extra piece that's just rendered over there that your camera shake can kind of move into. So we still have information there. Now, the option over here with the screen window does actually allow this. So you can do something like negative 1.1 and then 1.1, 1.1, 1.1. So that'll add 10% onto every side. And you can actually see that our volume doesn't follow that. So the shaped volume doesn't really work in this case, right? Because we're now extending past that. So, you know, there are options to fix that if you want to. But this is how you would do some overscan. So as far as I know, this is the only current way to do overscan. I may be wrong, but this is how I would do overscan at the moment. So if you want to overscan by 10% in every direction, you can do it like this under the screen window under comma. Now, once again, like I said, you can't really use the data window NDC for overscan in that case. Reset that and we can go into some more settings. Okay. So in certain cases, you may want to render deep camera maps. Now, I'm not going to get too much into deep camera maps in this tutorial, but the idea is that you can render depth information into your image. So a deep camera map is an EXR image, but what it has is extra depth information. One of the drawbacks of getting all of that extra depth information is that it creates a very large file. So instead of the 20 to 50 megabyte EXR that you would have for like a 1920 by 1080 image, you may be looking more towards 300 megabytes upwards, depending on the scene. So deep output can get very big. Do keep that in mind. Now, a deep camera map, also known as a DCM, is just a method of keeping track of depth information. What this allows is accurate compositing of semi-transparent objects. So say you have a scene with lots of semi-transparent sprites or volumes, then what you can do is instead of rendering by matting any object inside of the volume, you can render it with this DCM, so this deep camera map, and it'll hold all of the volume's depth information. So you could put something, say an opaque object, inside of the volume and move it back and forth within the volume and get the correct opacity for that volume. So you take an opaque object and you put it in a semi-transparent object, and the semi-transparent object reacts to it as if there is depth, right? So in other words, you move an object further back into a volume, it becomes more occluded. If you move it closer to the camera, it becomes less occluded. And that's what deep allows you to do in post, right? You can do that in your compositing stage. Now that is different from just matting out an area, because if you were to mat, you would lose that information that's at the back of the volume. So to output a deep camera map, you can go over to the deep output. And the settings have really been reduced. In Mantra, there were a lot more settings for DCM, but now it's kind of straightforward. So we have this DCM deep camera map and the DCM file name. So this will output a separate file to your output picture, right? It'll output your regular picture and it'll output this .dcm.f, right? Now over here, when it says DCM render vars, these are all of your AOVs. So in this case, I don't have any AOVs, but if I were to add one, so let's just go ahead and add diffuse and let's add volume, right? And then I go to my deep output. What you'll notice is that if we go over to where this is in our scene graph, then we can see that up here we have render, inside we have products, under that we have vars, beauty, combined, and volume, right? So these are our render variables. Now, if we want to include just a particular one, you can just change it. So we can include beauty only. So only beauty will get that deep information. By default, it will give it to all elements. So we can do it for only combined diffuse or for only volume, right? Now, what I would suggest, and I'm just going to set this back to the default, is to actually make a separate comma node. What you can do is you can prune out the volume. So let's go ahead and add this over here. And what you can do is let's just grab our volume, smoke, prune it out, right? So we can deactivate it. We no longer have smoke coming in here. And then we can switch it over to the side and say prune unselected. And then we can make a separate render node for the volume and for all of our opaque objects and then composite them together using that deep information. So what you can do is you can even create a reference copy. So actions create reference copy. And over here, you'll just have this, right? So now this copies over all of the information on this node over here. So if you make any changes to this node, you'll get these same settings over on this node over here. This one will just be rendering smoke because of this prune node. This one will just be rendering your opaque objects. And I believe it is suggested to separate all of your different semi-transparent objects into different deep sequences. So in this case, we have our opaque objects over here and we could render out, and over here we would have our others. So I would say that you could just go over to deep output and say delete channels, and this will allow you to change this individually. And do keep in mind that if you say render to disk, it will render both of them together. So you can also once again right click on this and say delete channels so that you have separate control over when you render. So an interesting thing is that you can actually just remove the output picture and get just the DCM. And then this DCM over here will be the large file that I'm talking about. What you will notice when you render out, and I'll show you this quickly, is, so this is a very low quality render, just for testing purposes. What you have over here is if you check out the layers, you have your RGB and alpha. But then you also have Z depth, and this is by default. You don't need to add it under the AOVs. The deep will generate this Z depth. It also has Z back. Z back is a bit different in that it finds the back of a particular semi-transparent object. So that just cuts off the depth information at that point. So ZBack is what that's used for. So that's basically what you would need to know for deep camera maps. One other thing is that because deep camera maps get so big, you may want to, and this is just a maybe, you may want to change the compression type for the EXR sequences. By default, the settings are pretty good. So if you go to image output and metadata, you have the EXR compression zip single scan line. That's by default, right? Zip is pretty good. So for most cases, zip is perfectly fine. And this is also kind of interesting. You can add information over here under the metadata to comments, artist, all of that, just as a side note. But EXR compression, right? You have the different compression types over here, where zip, single scan line, and multi-scan line are very similar. Run length encoding, also known as RLE, works best for large single colors. So for things like mats. So if you're rendering out a crypto mat, or you're rendering out like an alpha mask, then you might want to use this run length encoding. This PIZ wavelet, that's best for noisy, grainy images. But generally, you won't actually be changing this. So this is just something that's interesting if you do want to check it out. There's also DWAA and DWAB. These ones, you can actually adjust the compression setting as if it were like a JPEG, right? So if you enable this, you can see that you can increase the compression level, and that allows you to really compress things down. You do lose data though. So there is data loss with that compression type. There's also no compression. That's when you end up with the really big images. But yeah, you can stick to something like zip single scan line. Some other things that are pretty useful. If you go over to the advanced settings and you go under the driver, we have this cancel render if missing texture is discovered. This might save you some pain, but it can also cause some pain. So be careful about the cancel render if missing textures discovered. That can sometimes, you know, crash things. If you're using Redshift as well as Karma, and there may be some other renderers that also cause this, you may end up with an issue where when you try to render, you'll get an error and the render will cancel after a bit. So if you're having that issue, it might show up as a Houdini DSO error, I believe. So if you're getting a DSO error with Karma, it may be because you have another renderer installed. What you may need to do, and I'm just going to bring up my .env over here, is just open your .env file. And this can be found in users, and it would be your username, then documents, the current version of Houdini, and inside of there you'll find Houdini.env. And over there, you will need to change this over here. So as you can see, I have the path for Redshift, the Houdini path over here, and the PXR plugin name. What you can do is you can comment all of this out. So these last few lines, just comment them out and then try rendering in Karma if you are getting that DSO error. That is something that I have noticed happens. So yeah, just one thing to check out. And just one last thing for making your life a little bit easier. When rendering to disk, Karma doesn't bring up mplay. It is unlike Mantra and Redshift and a lot of other renderers in that they bring up mplay when you render to disk. Karma doesn't. So what you can do is you can go over to advanced, and then just at the last tab over here, there's mplay. You can say enable mplay monitor and then tell it which channels to preview, right? So it'll bring up your AOVs over here. You can tell it to display a particular one or to just display all of them. And what that is are these up here. So it's your C, combined diffuse, combined volume, right? That's your AOVs that are being brought up, your render variables. So that's one thing. If you render to disk and you want the mplay viewer, that's what you have to do. So that was some of the more advanced settings of Karma. I hope that that helped you to kind of understand how to use those settings a bit more. Those are some things that are kind of niche. You might not always want to use them, but when you do, they might come in handy. So do keep all of that in mind. I hope that it does help you. If I have gotten anything wrong, please leave a comment down below. I'll try to address it. There isn't much in terms of documentation for Karma, so a lot of this has been my own trial and error and experimenting with Karma. So I am probably prone to making many mistakes. So please correct me if I'm wrong on anything, and I would appreciate that if you just leave a comment. Try to be nice, I'm sensitive. But thank you for watching this series. Hopefully it helped you. If it did, please leave a comment, that'll be cool. And so yeah, that's it for this part, and that's it for this series. So that is the end of A Beautiful Game. Thank you for watching, and I will see you with the next series. Bye.